and point, holding a race with an epoch, when they show themselves infected with any moral fanaticism, seem like those intercalated periods of restraint and fasting, during which an impulse learns to humble and submit itself, at the same time also to purify and sharpen itself. Certain philosophical sects likewise admit of similar interpretation. For instance, the Stoa, in the midst of Hellenic culture, with the atmosphere rank and overcharged with aphrodisiacal odors. Here also is a hint for the explanation of the paradox, why it was precisely in the most Christian period of European history, and in general only under the pressure of Christian sentiments, that the sexual impulse sublimated into love, amor, passion. 190. There is something in the morality of Plato which does not really belong to Plato, but which only appears in his philosophy, one might say, in spite of him, namely, Socratism, for which he himself was too noble. No one desires to injure himself, hence all evil is done unwittingly. The evil man inflicts injury on himself. He would not do so, however, if he knew that evil is evil. The evil man, therefore, is only evil through error. If one frees him from error, one will necessarily make him good. This mode of reasoning savors of the populace, who perceive only the unpleasant consequences of evil-doing and practically judge that it is stupid to do wrong. While they accept good as identical with useful and pleasant, without further thought. As regards every system of utilitarianism, one may at once assume that it has the same origin and follow the scent. One will seldom err. Plato did all he could to interpret something refined and noble into the tenets of his teacher, and above all, to interpret himself into them. He, the most daring of all interpreters, who lifted the entire Socrates out of the street, as a popular theme and song, to exhibit him in endless and impossible modifications, namely, in all his own disguises and multiplicities. And yes, in numeric language as well, what is the Platonic Socrates, if not? Proste Platon opiten, te Platon teste techemaira. 191. The old theological problem of faith and knowledge, or more plainly, of instinct and reason. The question whether, in respect to the valuation of things, instinct deserves more authority than rationality, which wants to appreciate and act according to motives, according to a why, that is to say, in conformity to purpose and utility. It is always the old moral problem that first appeared in the person of Socrates and had divided men's minds long before Christianity. Socrates himself, following, of course, the taste of his talent, that of a surpassing dialectician, took at first the side of reason. And, in fact, what did he do all his life but laugh at the awkward incapacity of the noble Athenians, who were men of instinct, like all noble men, and could never give satisfactory answers concerning the motives of their actions. In the end, however, so silently and secretly, he laughed also at himself. With his finer conscience and introspection, he found in himself the same difficulty and incapacity. But why, he said to himself, should one on that account separate oneself from the instincts? One must set them right, and the reason also. One must follow the instinct, but at the same time persuade the reason to support them with good arguments. This was the real falseness of that great and mysterious ironist. He brought his conscience up to the point that he was satisfied with a kind of self-outwitting. In fact, he perceived the irrationality in the moral judgment. Plato, more innocent in such matters, and without the craftiness of the plebeian, wished to prove to himself, at the expenditure of all his strength, the greatest strength a philosopher had ever expended, that reason and instinct lead spontaneously to the one goal, to the good, to God. And since Plato, all theologians and philosophers have followed the same path, which means that in matters of morality, instinct, or as Christians call it, faith, or as I call it, the herd, has hitherto triumphed. Unless one should make an exception in the case of Descartes, the father of rationalism, and consequently the grandfather of the revolution, who recognized only the authority of reason. But reason is only a tool, and Descartes was superficial. 192. Whoever has followed the history of a single science finds in its development a clue to the understanding of the oldest and commonest processes of all knowledge and cognizance. There, as here, the premature hypothesis, the fictions, the good stupid will to believe, and the lack of distrust and patience are first developed. Our senses learn late, and never learn completely, to be subtle, reliable, and cautious organs of knowledge. Our eyes find it easier on a given occasion to produce a picture already often produced, than to seize upon the divergence and novelty of an impression. The latter requires more force, more morality. It is difficult and painful for the ear to listen to anything new. We hear strange music badly. When we hear another language spoken, we involuntarily attempt to form the sounds into words with which we are more familiar and conversant. It was thus, for example, that the Germans modified the spoken word Arkuballista into Armbrust, that means crossbow. Our senses are also hostile and averse to the new, and generally, even in the simplest procession of sensation, the emotions dominate, such as fear, love, hatred, and the passive emotion of indolence. As little as a reader nowadays reads all the single words, not to speak of syllables, of a page. He rather takes about 5 out of every 20 words at random, and guesses the probably appropriate sense to them. Just as little do we see a tree correctly and completely in respect to its leaves, branches, color, and shape. We find it so much easier to fancy the charms of a tree. Even in the midst of the most remarkable experiences, we still do just the same. We fabricate the greater part of the experience, and can hardly be made to contemplate any event, except as inventors thereof. All this goes to prove that from our fundamental nature, and from remote ages we have been accustomed to lying, or, to express it more politely and hypocritically, in short, more pleasantly. One is much more of an artist than one is aware of. In an animated conversion, I often see the face of the person with whom I am speaking so clearly and sharply defined before me, according to the thought he expresses, or which I believe to be evoked in his mind, that the degree of distinctness far exceeds the strength of my visual faculty. The delicacy of the play of the muscles and of the expression of the eyes must therefore be imagined by me. Probably the person put on quite a different expression, or none at all. 193. Quidquid luce fuit, tenebris agit, but also contrariwise. What we experience in dreams, provided we experience it often, pertains at last just as much to the general belongings of our soul as anything actually experienced. By virtue thereof, we are richer or poorer, we have a requirement more or less, and finally, in broad daylight, and even in the brightest moments of our waking life, we are ruled to some extent by the nature of our dreams. Supposing that someone has often flown in his dreams, and then at last, as soon as he dreams, he is conscious of the power and art of flying as his privilege and his peculiarly inviolable happiness. Such a person who believes that on the slightest impulse he can actually all sorts of curves and angels, who knows the sensation of a certain divine levity, and upwards, without effort or constraint, and downwards, without ascending or lowering, without trouble. How could the man with such dream experiences and dream habits fail to find happiness differently colored and defined, even in his waking hours? How could he fail to long differently for happiness? Flight, such as is described by poets, must, when compared with his own flying, be far too earthly, muscular, violent, far too troublesome for him. 194. The difference among men does not manifest itself only in the difference of their list of desirable things, in their regarding different good things as worth striving for, and being disagreed as to the greater or less value, the order of rank, of the commonly recognized desirable things. It manifests itself much more in what they regard as actually having and possessing a desirable thing. As regards to a woman, for instance, the control over her body and her sexual gratification serves as an amply sufficient sign of ownership and possession to the more modest man. Another, with a more suspicious and ambitious thirst for possession, sees the questionableness, the mere apparentness of such ownership, and wishes to have finer tests in order to know, especially whether the woman not only gives herself to him, but also gives up for the sake what she has or would not like to have. Only then does he look upon her as possessed. A third, however, has not even here got to the limit of his distrust and his desire for possession. He asks himself whether the woman, when she gives up everything for him, does not perhaps do so far for a phantom of him. He wishes first to be thoroughly, indeed, profoundly well known. In order to be loved at all, he ventures to let himself be found out. Only then does he feel the beloved one fully in his possession, when she no longer deceives herself about him, when she loves him just as much for the sake of his devilry and concealed insatiability as for his goodness, patience, and spirituality. One man would like to possess a nation, and he finds all the higher arts of Cagliostro and Catalina suitable for his purpose. Another, with a more refined thirst of possession, says to himself, one may not deceive where one desires to possess. He is irritated and impatient at the idea that a mask of him should rule in the hearts of the people. I must, therefore, make myself known, and first of all, learn to know myself. Among helpful and charitable people, one almost always finds the awkward craftiness which first gets up suitable him who has to be helped, as though, for instance, he should merit help, seek just their help, and would show himself deeply grateful, attached, and subservient to them for all help. With these conceits, they take control of the needy as a property, just as in general they are charitable and helpful out of a desire for property. One finds them jealous when they are crossed or forestalled in their charity. Parents involuntarily make something like themselves out of the children. They call that education. No mother doubts at the bottom of her heart that the child she has born is thereby her property. No father hesitates about his right to his own ideas and notions of worth. Indeed, in former times, fathers seemed to try to use their discretion concerning the life or death of the newly born, as among the ancient Germans. And like the father, so also do the teacher, the class, the priest, and the prince still see in every new individual an unobjectionable opportunity for new possession. The consequence is 195. The Jews, a people born for slavery, as Tacitus and the whole ancient world say of them, the chosen people among the nations, as they themselves say and believe. The Jews performed the miracle of the inversion of valuations, by means of which the life on earth obtained a new and dangerous charm for a couple of millenniums. The prophets fused into one his expressions rich, godless, wicked, violent, sensual, and for the first time coined the word world as a term of reproach. In this inversion of valuations, in which is also included the use of the word poor, a synonym with saint and friend, the significance of the Jewish people is to be found. It is with them that the slave insurrection in morals commences. 196. It is to be inferred that there are countless dark bodies near the sun, such as we shall never see. Among ourselves, this is an allegory, and the psychologist of morals reads the whole star writing merely as an allegorical and symbolic language in which much may be unexpressed. 197. The beast of prey and the man of prey, for instance, Caesar Borgia, are fundamentally misunderstood. Nature is misunderstood. So long as one seeks a morbidness in the constitution of these healthiest of all tropical monsters and growths, or even an innate hell in them, as almost all moralists have done hitherto, does it not seem that there is a hatred of the virgin forest and of the tropics among moralists, and that the tropical man must be discredited at all costs, whether as a disease and deterioration of mankind, or as his own hell and self-torture? And why? In favor of the temperate zones? In favor of the temperate man? The moral? The mediocre? This for the chapter, Morals as Timidity. 198. All the systems of morals which address themselves with a view of their happiness, as it is called, what else are they but suggestions for behavior adapted to the degree of danger from themselves in which the individuals live? Recipes for their passions, their good and bad propensities, in so far as such have the will to power and would like to play the master. Small and great expediencies and elaborations, permeated with the musty odor of old family medicines and old wife wisdom, all of them grotesque and absurd in their form, because they address themselves to all, because they generalize where the generalization is not authorized, all of them speaking unconditionally and taking themselves unconditionally, all of them flavored not merely with some grain of salt, but rather endurable only, and sometimes even seductive when they are overspiced and begin to smell dangerously, especially of the other world. That is all of little value when estimated intellectually, and is far from being science, much less wisdom. But, repeated once more, and three times repeated, it is expediency, 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 mixed with stupidity, stupidity, stupidity. Whether it be indifference and statuesque coldness towards the heated folly of the emotions, which the Stoics advised and fostered, or the no more laughing and no more weeping of Spinoza, the destruction of the emotions by their analysis and vivisection, which he recommended so naively, or the lowering of the emotions to an innocent mean at which they all may be satisfied, the Aristotelianism of morals, or even morality as the enjoyment of the emotions, in a voluntary attenuation and spiritualization by the symbolism of art, perhaps as music, or as love of God, and of mankind for God's sake. For in religion, the passions are once more enfranchised, provided that, or, finally, even the complacent and wanton surrender of the emotions, as has been taught by Hafez and Goethe, the bold letting go of the reins, the spiritual and corporeal licentia morum, in the exceptional cases of wise cold codgers and drunkards, with whom it no longer has much danger. This also for the chapter, Moral as Timidity. 199. Inasmuch as in all ages, as long as mankind has existed, there have also been human herds, family alliances, communities, tribes, peoples, states, churches. And always a great number of who obey in proportion to the small number who command. In view, therefore, of the fact that obedience has been most practiced and fostered among mankind hitherto, one may reasonably suppose that, generally speaking, the need thereof is now innate in every one, as a kind of formal conscience which gives the command, "You shall unconditionally do something, unconditionally refrain from something." In short, you shall. This need tries to satisfy itself and to fill its form with the content, according to its strength, impatience, and eagerness. It at once ceases as an omnivorous appetite, with little selection, and accepts whatever is shouted into its ear by all sorts of commanders, parents, teachers, laws, class prejudice, or public opinion. The extraordinary limitation of human development, the hesitation, protractedness, frequent retrogression, and turning thereof, is attributable to the fact that the herd instinct of obedience is transmitted best, and at the cost of the art of command. If one imagines this instinct increasing to its greatest extent, commanders and independent individuals will finally be lacking altogether, or they will suffer inwardly from a bad conscience, and will have to impose a deception of themselves in the first place, in order to be able to command just as if they also were only obeying. This condition of things actually exists in Europe at present. I call it the moral hypocrisy of the commanding class. They know no other way of protecting themselves from their bad conscience than by playing the role of executors of older and higher orders, of predecessors, of the constitution, of justice, of the law, or of God himself, or they even justify themselves by maxims from the current opinions of the herd, as first servants of their people, or instruments of the public will. On the other hand, the gregarious European man nowadays assumes an air as if he were the only kind of man that is allowable. He glorifies his qualities, such as public spirit, kindness, deference, industry, temperance, modesty, indulgence, sympathy, by virtue of which he is gentle, endurable, and useful to the herd, as a peculiarly human virtues. In cases, however, where it is believed that the leader and bellwether cannot be dispensed with, attempt after attempt is made nowadays to replace commanders by the summing together of clever, gregarious men. All representative constitutions, for example, are of this origin. In spite of all, what a blessing, what a deliverance from a weight becoming unendurable, is the appearance of an absolute ruler for these gregarious Europeans. Of this fact, the effect of the appearance of Napoleon was the last great proof. The history of the influence of Napoleon is almost the history of the higher happiness to which the entire century has attained in its worthiest individuals and periods. 200. The man of an age of dissolution, which mixes the races with one another, who has the inheritance of a diversified descent in his body, that is to say, contrary, and often not only contrary, instincts and standards of value, which struggle with one another and are seldom at peace. Such a man of late culture and broken lives will, on an average, be a weak man. His fundamental desire is that the war which is in him should come to an end. Happiness appears to him in the character of a soothing medicine and mode of thought, for instance, Epicurean or Christian. It is above all things the happiness of repose, of undisturbedness, of repletion, of final unity. It is the Sabbat of Sabbats, to use the expression of the holy rhetorician St. Augustine, who was himself such a man. Should, however, the contrary and conflict in such natures operate as an additional incentive and stimulus to life, and if, on the other hand, in addition to their powerful and irreconcilable instinct, they have also inherited and indoctrinated into them a proper mastery and subtlety for carrying on the conflict which themselves, that is to say, the faculty of self-control and self-deception. There then arise those marvelously incomprehensible and inexplicable beings, those enigmatical men, predestined for conquering and circumventing others, the finest examples of which are Alcibiades and Caesar, with whom I should like to associate the first of Europeans, according to my taste, the Hohenstaufern, Frederick II, and among artists, perhaps Leonardo da Vinci. They appear precisely in the same periods when that weaker type, which is longing for repose, comes to the front. The two types are complementary to each other, and spring from the same causes. 201. As long as the utility which determines moral estimates is only gregarious utility, as long as the preservation of the community is only kept in view, and the immoral is sought precisely and exclusively in what seems dangerous to the maintenance of the community, there can be no morality of love to one's neighbor. Granted even that there is already a little constant exercise of consideration, sympathy, fairness, gentleness, and mutual assistance, granted that even in this condition of society, all those instincts are already active, which are latterly distinguished by honorable names as virtues, and eventually almost coincide with the conception morality. In that period, they do not as yet belong to the domain of moral valuations. They are still ultra-moral. A sympathetic action, for instance, is neither called good nor bad, moral or immoral, in the best periods of the Romans. And should it be praised, a sort of resentful disdain is compatible with this praise. Even at the best, directly the sympathetic action is compared with one which contributes to the welfare of the whole, to the res publica. After all, love to our neighbor is always a secondary matter, partly conventional and arbitrarily manifested in relation to our fear of our neighbor. After the fabric of society seems on the whole established and secured against external dangers, it is the fear of our neighbor which again creates new perspectives of moral valuation. Certain strong and dangerous instincts, such as the love of enterprise, foolhardiness, revengefulness, astuteness, rapacity, and love of power, which up till then has not only been honored from the point of view of general utility, under other names, of course, than those here given, but had to be fostered and cultivated, because they were perpetually required in the common danger against the common enemies, are now felt in the dangerousness to be doubly strong. When the outlets for them are lacking, and are gradually branded as immoral and given over calumny, the contrary instincts and inclinations now attain to moral honor. The gregarious instinct gradually draws its conclusions. How much or how little dangerousness to the community or to equality is contained in an opinion, a condition, an emotion, a disposition, or an endowment? That is now the moral perspective. Here again, fear is the mother of morals. It is by the loftiest and strongest instinct, when they break out passionately and carry the individual far above and beyond the average, and the low level of the gregarious conscience, that the self-reliance of the community is destroyed, its belief in itself, its backbone, as it were, breaks. Consequently, these very instincts will be most branded and defamed. The lofty independent spirituality, the will to stand alone, and even the cogent reason are felt to be dangerous. Everything that elevates the individual above the herd and is a source of fear to the neighbor is henceforth called evil. the tolerant, unassuming, self-adapting, self-equalizing disposition, the mediocrity of desires, attains to moral distinction and honor. Finally, under very peaceful circumstances, there's always less opportunity and necessity for training the feelings to severity and rigor. And now every form of severity, even injustice, begins to disturb the conscience. A lofty and rigorous nobleness and self-responsibility almost offends and awakens distrust. The lamb, and still more, the sheep, wins respect. There is a point of diseased mellowness and effeminacy in the history of society, at which society itself takes the part of him who injures it, the part of the criminal, and does so, in fact, seriously and honestly. To punish appears to it to be somehow unfair. It is certain that the idea of punishment and the obligation to punish are then painful and alarming to people. Is it not sufficient that the criminal be rendered harmless? Why should we still punish? Punishment itself is terrible. With these questions, gregarious morality, the morality of fear, draws its ultimate conclusion. If one could at all do away with danger, the cause of fear, one would have done away with this morality at the same time. It would no longer be necessary. It would not consider itself any longer necessary. Whoever examines the conscience of the present-day European will always elicit the same imperative from its thousand moral faults and hidden recesses, the imperative of the timidity of the herd. We wish that some time or other there may be nothing more to fear. Sometime or other, the will and the way thereto is nowadays called progress all over Europe. 202. Let us at once say again what we have already said 100 times, for people's ears nowadays are unwilling to hear such truth, our truth. We know well enough how offensive it sounds when anyone plainly, and without metaphor, counts men among the animals. But it will be accounted to us almost a crime that it is precisely in respect to men of modern ideas that we have constantly applied the terms herd, herd instincts, and such like expressions. What avail is it? We cannot do otherwise, for it is precisely here that our new insight is. We have found that in all the principal moral judgments, Europe has become unanimous, including likewise the countries where European influence prevails. In Europe, people evidently know what Socrates thought he did not know, and what the famous serpent of old once promised to teach. They know today what is good and evil. It must then sound hard and be distasteful to the ear when we always insist that that which here thinks it knows, that which here glorifies itself with praise and blame, and calls itself good, is the instinct of the herding human animal, the instinct which has come and is ever coming more and more to the front, to preponderance and supremacy over other instincts, according to the increasing physiological approximation and resemblance of which is it the symptom. Morality in Europe at present is herding animal morality. And therefore, as we understand the matter, only one kind of human morality, besides which, before which, and after which many other moralities, and above all higher moralities, are or should be possible. Against such a possibility, against such a should be, however, this morality defends itself with all its strength. It says obstinately and inexorably, I am morality itself, and nothing else is morality. Indeed, with the help of a religion which has humored and flattered the sublime desires of the herding animal, things have reached such a point that we always find a more visible expression of this morality, even in political and social arrangements. The democratic movement is the inheritance of the Christian movement. That its tempo, however, is much too slow and sleepy for the more impatient ones. For those who are sick and distracted by the herding instinct, is indicated by the increasingly furious howling and always less disguised teeth-gnashing of the anarchist dogs who are now roving through the highways of European culture. Apparently in opposition to the peacefully industrious democrats and revolution ideologies, and still more so to the awkward philosophers and fraternity visionaries who call themselves socialists and want a free society. Those are really at one with them in all their thorough and instinctive hostility to every form of society other than the autonomous herd, to the extent even of repudiating the notions master and servant. Ni Dieu ni Maître, says the socialist formula, at one in the tenacious opposition to every special claim, every special right and privilege. This means, ultimately, opposition to every right. For when we are all equal, no one needs the rights any longer. At one in their distrust of punitive justice, as though it were a violation of the weak, unfair to the necessary consequences of all former society. But equally at one in their religion of sympathy, in their compassion for all that feels, lives and suffers, down to the very animals, up even to God. The extravagance of the sympathy for God belongs to a democratic age. Altogether at one in the cry and impatience of the sympathy, in the deadly hatred of suffering generality, in their almost feminine incapacity for witnessing it or allowing it. At one in their involuntarily beglooming and heart softening, under the spell of which Europe seems to be threatened with a new Buddhism. At one in their belief in the morality of mutual sympathy, as though it were morality in itself, the climax, the attained climax of mankind, the sole hope of the future, the consolation of the present, the great discharge from all the obligations of the past. Altogether at one in their belief in the community as the deliverer, in the herd, and therefore in themselves. 203. We, who hold a different belief, we, who regard the democratic movement not only as a degenerating form of political organization, but as equivalent to a generating, a waning type of man, as involving his mediocrizing and deprecation. Where have we to fix our hopes? In new philosophers, there is no other alternative. In minds, strong and original enough to initiate opposite estimates of values, to transvalue and invert eternal valuations. In forerunners, in men of the futures, who in the present shall fix the constraints and fast the knots which will compel millennials to take new paths. To teach man the future of humanity as his will, as depending on human will, and to make preparation for vast, hazardous enterprises and collective attempts in rearing and educating, in order thereby to put an end to the frightful rule of folly and chance, which has hitherto gone by the name of history. The folly of the greatest number is only its last form. For that purpose, a new type of philosopher and commander will sometime or other be needed, and the very idea of which everything that has existed in the way of occult, terrible, and benevolent beings might look pale and dwarfed. The image of such leaders hovers before our eyes. Is it lawful for me to say it aloud, we free spirits? The conditions which one would partly have to create and partly utilize for their genesis. the presumptive methods and tests by virtue, of which a soul should grow up to such an evaluation and power as to feel a constraint to these tasks, a transvaluation of values under the new pressure and hammer, of which a conscience should be steeled and a heart transformed into brass, so as to bear the weight of such responsibility, and on the other hand, the necessity for our such leaders. And, on the other hand, the necessity for such leaders, the dreadful danger that they might be lacking, or miscarry, and degenerate. These are our real anxieties and glooms. We know it well, we free spirits. These are the heavy distant thoughts and storms which sweep across the heaven of our life. There are few pains so grievous as to have seen, divined, or experienced how an exceptional man has missed his way and deteriorated. But he, who has a rare eye for the universal danger of man himself deteriorating, he, who like us, has recognized the extraordinary fortitude which has Cicero played its game in respect of the future of mankind. A game in which neither the hand nor even a finger of God has participated. He who divines the fate that is hidden under the idiotic unwariness and blind confidence of modern ideas, and still more under the whole of Christo-European morality, suffers from an anguish with which no other is to be compared. He sees at a glance all that could still be made out of man through a favorable accumulation and augmentation of human powers and arrangements. He knows, with all the knowledge of his conviction, how unexhausted man still is for the greatest possibilities, and how often in the past the type man has stood in presence of mysterious decisions and new paths. He knows still better from his painfulest recollections on what rash obstacles promising developments of the highest rank have hitherto usually gone to pieces, broken down, sunk, and become contemptible. The universal degeneracy of mankind to the level of the man of the future, as idealized by the socialist fools and shallow pates. This degeneracy and dwarfing of man to an absolutely gregarious animal, or as they call it, to a man of free society. This brutalizing of man into a pygmy with equal rights and claims is undoubtedly possible. He who has thought out this possibility to his ultimate conclusion knows an other lousing unknown to the rest of mankind, and perhaps also a new mission. End of chapter 5.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This reading by Kara Schallenberg, www.kray.org. Beyond Good and Evil by Friedrich Nietzsche. Chapter 6. We Scholars. 204. At the risk that moralizing may also reveal itself here as that which it has always been, namely, resolutely montrer ses plaies, according to Balzac, I would venture to protest against an improper and injurious alteration of rank, which, quite unnoticed, and as if with the best conscience, threatens nowadays to establish itself in the relations of science and philosophy. I mean to say that one must have the right, out of one's own experience. Experience, as it seems to me, always implies unfortunate experience. To treat of such an important question of rank, so as not to speak of color like the blind, or against science like women and artists. Ah, this dreadful science! Sigh their instinct and their shame. it always finds things out. The Declaration of Independence of the Scientific Man, his emancipation from philosophy, is one of the subtler after-effects of democratic organization and disorganization. The self-glorification and self-conceitedness of the learned man is now everywhere in full bloom, and in its best springtime. Which does not mean to imply that in this case self-praise smells sweet. Here also the instinct of the populace cries, "Freedom from all masters!" And, after science has, with the happiest results, resisted theology, whose handmaid it had been too long, it now proposes, in its wantonness and indiscretion, to lay down laws for philosophy, and in its turn to play the master. What am I saying? To play the philosopher, on its own account. My memory, the memory of a scientific man, if you please, teems with the naivetés of insolence which I have heard about philosophy and philosophers from young naturalists and old physicians. Not to mention the most cultured and most conceited of all learned men, the philologists and schoolmasters, who are both the one and the other by profession. On one occasion it was the specialist and the Jack Horner who instinctively stood on the defensive against all synthetic tasks and capabilities. At another time it was the industrious worker who had got a scent of otium and refined luxuriousness in the internal economy of the philosopher, and felt himself aggrieved and belittled thereby. On another occasion it was the color blindness of the utilitarian, who sees nothing in philosophy but a series of refuted systems, and an extravagant expenditure which does nobody any good. At another time, the fear of disguised mysticism and of the boundary adjustment of knowledge became conspicuous. At another time, the disregard of individual philosophers, which had involuntarily extended to disregard of philosophy generally. In fine, I found most frequently, behind the proud disdain of philosophy in young scholars, the evil after-effect of some particular philosopher, to whom, on the whole, obedience had been forsworn, without, however, the spell of his scornful estimates of other philosophers having been got rid of, the result of being a general ill-will to all philosophy. Such seems to me, for instance, the after-effect of Schopenhauer on the most modern Germany. By his unintelligent rage against Hegel, he has succeeded in severing the whole of the last generation of Germans from its connection with German culture, which culture, all things considered, has been an elevation and a divining refinement of the historical sense. But precisely at this point Schopenhauer himself was poor, irreceptive, and un-German to the extent of ingeniousness. On the whole, speaking generally, it may just have been the humanness, all too humanness, of the modern philosophers themselves, in short, their contemptibleness, which has injured most radically the reverence for philosophy and opened the doors to the instinct of the populace. Let it but be acknowledged to what an extent our modern world diverges from the whole style of the world of Heraclitus, Plato, Empedocles, and whatever else all the royal and magnificent anchorites of the spirit were called, and with what justice an honest man of science may feel himself of a better family and origin, in view of such representatives of philosophy, who, owing to the fashion of the present day, are just as much aloft as they are down below. In Germany, for instance, the two lions of Berlin, the anarchist Eugen Döring, and the amalgamist Eduard von Hartmann. It is especially the sight of those hotchpotch philosophers who call themselves realists, or positivists, which is calculated to implant a dangerous distrust in the soul of a young and ambitious scholar. Those philosophers, at the best, are themselves but scholars and specialists. That is very evident. All of them are persons who have been vanquished and brought back again under the dominion of science, who, at one time or another, claimed more from themselves, without having a right to the more and its responsibility, and who now, creditably, rancorously, and vindictively, represent in word and deed disbelief in the master task and supremacy of philosophy. After all, how could it be otherwise? Science flourishes nowadays, and has the good conscience clearly visible on its countenance, while that to which the entire modern philosophy has gradually sunk, the remnant of philosophy of the present day, excites distrust and displeasure, if not scorn and pity. Philosophy reduced to a theory of knowledge, no more in fact than a diffident science of epochs and doctrine of forbearance, a philosophy that never even gets beyond the threshold, and rigorously denies itself the right to enter. That is philosophy in its last throes, an end, an agony, something that awakens pity. How could such a philosophy rule? 205. The dangers that beset the evolution of the philosopher are, in fact, so manifold nowadays, that one might doubt whether this fruit could still come to maturity. The extent and towering structure of the sciences have increased enormously, and therewith also the probability that the philosopher will grow tired even as a learner, or will attach himself somewhere and specialize, so that he will no longer attain to his elevation, that is to say, to his superspection, his circumspection, and his despection. Or he gets aloft too late, when the best of his maturity and strength is past, or when he is impaired, coarsened, and deteriorated, so that his view, his general estimate of things, is no longer of much importance. It is perhaps just the refinement of his intellectual conscience that makes him hesitate and linger on the way. He dreads the temptation to become a dilettante, a millipede, a milliantenna. He knows too well that, as a discerner, one who has lost his self-respect no longer commands, no longer leads, unless he should aspire to become a great play-actor, a philosophical Cagliostro, and spiritual rat-catcher, in short, a misleader. This is, in the last instance, a question of taste, if it has not really been a question of conscience. To double once more the philosopher's difficulties, there is also the fact that he demands from himself a verdict, a yea or nay, not concerning science, but concerning life and the worth of life. He learns unwillingly to believe that it is his right and even his duty to obtain this verdict, and he has to seek his way to the right and the belief only through the most extensive, perhaps disturbing and destroying, experiences, often hesitating, doubting, and dumbfounded. In fact, the philosopher has long been mistaken and confused by the multitude, either with the scientific man and ideal scholar, or with the religiously elevated, desensualized, desecularized visionary and God-intoxicated man. And even yet, when one hears anybody praised, because he lives wisely, or as a philosopher, it hardly means anything more than prudently and apart. Wisdom. That seems to the populace to be a kind of flight, a means and artifice for withdrawing successfully from a bad game. But the genuine philosopher, does it not seem so to us, my friends, lives unphilosophically and unwisely, above all, imprudently, and feels the obligation and burden of 100 attempts and temptations of life. He risks himself constantly. He plays this bad game. 206. In relation to the genius, that is to say, a being who either engenders or produces, both words understood in their fullest sense, the man of learning, the scientific average man, has always something of the old maid about him, for, like her, he is not conversant with the two principal functions of man. To both, of course, to the scholar and to the old maid, one concedes respectability, as if by way of indemnification. In these cases, one emphasizes the respectability. And yet, in the compulsion of this concession, one has the same admixture of vexation. Let us examine more closely. What is the scientific man? Firstly, a commonplace type of man, with commonplace virtues. That is to say, a non-ruling, non-authoritative, and non-self-sufficient type of man. He possesses industry, patient adaptableness to rank and file, equability and moderation in capacity and requirement. He has the instinct for people like himself, and for that which they require. For instance, the portion of independence and green meadow, without which there is no rest from labor, the claim to honor and consideration, which first and foremost presupposes recognition and recognizability, the sunshine of a good name, the perpetual ratification of his value and usefulness, with which the inward distrust which lies at the bottom of the heart of all dependent men and gregarious animals, has again and again to be overcome. The learned man, as is appropriate, has also maladies and faults of an ignoble kind. He is full of petty envy, and has a lynx eye for the weak points in those natures to whose elevations he cannot attain. He is confiding, yet only as one who lets himself go, but does not flow. And precisely before the man of the great current he stands all the colder and more reserved. His eye is then like a smooth and irresponsive lake, which is no longer moved by rapture or sympathy. The worst and most dangerous thing of which a scholar is capable results from the instinct of mediocrity of his type, from the Jesuitism of mediocrity, which labors instinctively for the destruction of the exceptional man, and endeavors to break, or still better, to relax, every bent bow. To relax, of course, with consideration, and naturally with an indulgent hand, to relax with confiding sympathy, that is the real art of Jesuitism, which has always understood how to introduce itself as the religion of sympathy. 207. However gratefully one may welcome the objective spirit, and who has not been sick to death of all subjectivity and its confounded ipsissimosity, in the end, however, one must learn caution even with regard to one's gratitude, and put a stop to the exaggeration with which the unselfing and depersonalizing of the spirit has recently been celebrated, as if it were the goal in itself, as if it were salvation and glorification, as is especially accustomed to happen in the pessimist school, which has also, in its turn, good reasons for paying the highest honors to disinterested knowledge. The objective man, who no longer curses and scolds like the pessimist, the ideal man of learning, in whom the scientific instinct blossoms forth fully after a thousand complete and partial failures, is assuredly one of the most costly instruments that exist, but his place is in the hand of one who is more powerful. He is only an instrument. We may say he is a mirror. He has no purpose in himself. The objective man is in truth a mirror, accustomed to prostration before everything that wants to be known, with such desires only as knowing or reflecting implies. He waits until something comes, and then expands himself sensitively, so that even the light footsteps and gliding past of spiritual beings may not be lost on his surface and film. Whatever personality he still possesses seems to him accidental, arbitrary, or, still oftener, disturbing. So much has he come to regard himself as the passage and reflection of outside forms and events. He calls up the recollection of himself with an effort, and, not infrequently wrongly, he readily confounds himself with other persons. He makes mistakes with regard to his own needs, and here only is he unrefined and negligent. Perhaps he is troubled about the health, or the pettiness and confined atmosphere of wife and friend, or the lack of companions and society. Indeed, he sets himself to reflect on his suffering, but in vain. His thoughts already rove away to the more general case, and tomorrow he knows as little as he knew yesterday how to help himself. He does not now take himself seriously and devote time to himself. He is serene, not from lack of trouble, but from lack of capacity for grasping and dealing with his trouble. The habitual complacence with respect to all objects and experiences, the radiant and impartial hospitality with which he receives everything that comes his way, his habit of inconsiderate good nature, of dangerous indifference as to yea and nay, alas, there are enough of cases in which he has to atone for these virtues of his, and as man generally, he becomes far too easily the caput mortuum of such virtues. Should one wish love or hatred from him, I mean love and hatred as God, woman, and animal understand them, he will do what he can, and furnish what he can. But one must not be surprised if it should not be much, if he should show himself just at this point to be false, fragile, questionable, and deteriorated. His love is constrained, his hatred is artificial, and rather, un tour de force, a slight ostentation and exaggeration. He is only genuine so far as he can be objective. Only in his serene totality is he still nature and natural. His mirroring and eternally self-polishing soul no longer knows how to affirm, no longer how to deny. He does not command, neither does he destroy. Je ne méprise presque rien, he says, with Leibniz. Let us not overlook nor undervalue the presque. Neither is he a model man. He does not go in advance of anyone, nor after either. He places himself generally too far off to have any reason for espousing the cause of either good or evil. If he has been so long confounded with the philosopher, with the Caesarian trainer and dictator of civilization, he has had far too much honor, and what is more essential in him has been overlooked. He is an instrument, something of a slave, though certainly the sublimest sort of slave, but nothing in himself. Presque rien. The objective man is an instrument, a costly, easily injured, easily tarnished measuring instrument and mirroring apparatus, which is to be taken care of and respected. But he is no goal, not outgoing nor upgoing, no complementary man in whom the rest of existence justifies itself, no termination, and still less a commencement, an engendering, or primary cause, nothing hardy, powerful, self-centered that wants to be master, but rather only a soft, inflated, delicate, movable potter's form, that must wait for some kind of content and frame to shape itself thereto. For the most part, a man without frame and content, a selfless man. Consequently, also, nothing for women. In parenthesi. 208. When a philosopher nowadays makes it known that he is not a skeptic, I hope that has been gathered from the foregoing description of the objective spirit, people all hear it impatiently. They regard him on that account with some apprehension. They would like to ask so many, many questions. Indeed, among timid hearers, of whom there are now so many, he is henceforth said to be dangerous. With his repudiation of skepticism, it seems to them as if they heard some evil threatening sound in the distance, as if a new kind of explosive were being tried somewhere, a dynamite of the spirit, perhaps a newly discovered Russian nihiline, a pessimism bonae voluntatis, that not only denies, means denial, but, dreadful thought, practices denial. Against this kind of good will, a will to the veritable, actual negation of life, there is, as is generally acknowledged nowadays, no better soporific and sedative than skepticism, the mild, pleasing, lulling poppy of skepticism. And Hamlet himself is now prescribed by the doctors of the day as an antidote to the spirit and its underground noises. Are not our ears already full of bad sounds, say the skeptics, as lovers of repose, and almost as a kind of safety police? This subterranean neigh is terrible. Be still, ye pessimistic moles. The skeptic, in effect that delicate creature, is far too easily frightened. His conscience is schooled so as to start at every nay, and even at that sharp, decided yea, and feels something like a bite thereby. Yea and nay, they seem to him opposed to morality. He loves, on the contrary, to make a festival to his virtue by a noble aloofness, while perhaps he says with Montaigne, "What do I know?" Or with Socrates, "I know that I know nothing." Or, "Here I do not trust myself. No door is open to me." Or, "Even if the door were open, why should I enter immediately?" Or, "What is the use of any hasty hypotheses? It might quite well be in good taste to make no hypotheses at all. Are you absolutely obliged to straighten at once what is crooked, to stuff every hole with some kind of oakum? Is there not time enough for that? Has not the time leisure? Oh, ye demons, can ye not at all wait?" The uncertain also has its charms. The Sphinx, too, is a Circe, and Circe, too, was a philosopher. Thus does a skeptic console himself, and in truth he needs some consolation. For skepticism is the most spiritual expression of a certain many-sided physiological temperament, which in ordinary language is called nervous debility and sickliness. It arises whenever races or classes, which have been long separated, decisively and suddenly blend with one another. In the new generation, which has inherited, as it were, different standards and valuations in its blood, everything is disquiet, derangement, doubt, and tentativeness. The best powers operate restrictively, the very virtues prevent each other growing and becoming strong. Equilibrium, ballast, and perpendicular stability are lacking in body and soul. That, however, which is most diseased and degenerated in such nondescripts, is the will. They are no longer familiar with independence of decision, or the courageous feeling of pleasure in willing. They are doubtful of the freedom of the will, even in their dreams. Our present-day Europe, the scene of a senseless, precipitate attempt at a racial blending of classes, and consequently of races, is therefore skeptical in all its heights and depths, sometimes exhibiting the mobile skepticism which springs impatiently and wantonly from branch to branch, sometimes with gloomy aspect, like a cloud overcharged with interrogative signs, and often sick unto death of its will. Paralysis of will! Where do we not find this cripple sitting nowadays? And yet, how bedecked oftentimes! How seductively ornamented! There are the finest gala dresses and disguises for this disease, and that, for instance, most of what places itself nowadays in the showcases as objectiveness, the scientific spirit, l'art pour l'art, and pure voluntary knowledge, is only decked-out skepticism and paralysis of will. I am ready to answer for this diagnosis of the European disease. The disease of the will is diffused unequally over Europe. It is worst and most varied where civilization has longest prevailed. It decreases according as the barbarian still, or again, asserts his claims under the loose drapery of Western culture. It is therefore in the France of today, as can be readily disclosed and comprehended, that the will is most infirm, and France, which has always had a masterly aptitude for converting even the portentous crisis of its spirit into something charming and seductive, now manifests emphatically its intellectual ascendancy over Europe by being the school and exhibition of all the charms of skepticism. The power to will and to persist, moreover, in a resolution, is already somewhat stronger in Germany, and again in the north of Germany it is stronger than in central Germany. It is considerably stronger in England, Spain, and Corsica, associated with phlegm in the former and with hard skulls in the latter, not to mention Italy, which is too young yet to know what it wants, and must first show whether it can exercise will, but it is strongest and most surprising of all in that immense middle empire where Europe, as it were, flows back to Asia, namely, in Russia. There the power to will has been long stored up and accumulated. There the will, uncertain whether to be negative or affirmative, waits threateningly to be discharged, to borrow their pet phrase from our physicists. Perhaps not only Indian wars and complications in Asia would be necessary to free Europe from its greatest danger, but also internal subversion, the shattering of the empire into small states, and above all the introduction of parliamentary imbecility, together with the obligation of everyone to read his newspaper at breakfast. I do not say this as one who desires it. In my heart I should rather prefer the contrary. I mean such an increase in the threatening attitude of Russia that Europe would have to make up its mind to become equally threatening, namely, to acquire one will by means of a new caste to rule over the continent, a persistent, dreadful will of its own, that can set its aims thousands of years ahead, so that the long, spun-out comedy of its petty statism, and its dynastic as well as its democratic many-willedness, might finally be brought to a close. The time for petty politics is past. The next century will bring the struggle for the dominion of the world, the compulsion to great politics. 209. As to how far the new warlike age on which we Europeans have evidently entered may perhaps favor the growth of another and stronger kind of skepticism, I should like to express myself preliminarily merely by a parable, which the lovers of German history will already understand. That unscrupulous enthusiast for big, handsome grenadiers, who, as King of Prussia, brought into being a military and skeptical genius, and therewith, in reality, the new and now triumphantly emerged type of German, the problematic, crazy father of Frederick the Great had on one point the very knack and lucky grasp of the genius. He knew what was then lacking in Germany, the want of which was 100 times more alarming and serious than any lack of culture and social form. His ill will to the young Frederick resulted from the anxiety of a profound instinct. Men were lacking, and he suspected, to his bitterest regret, that his own son was not man enough. There, however, he deceived himself, but who would not have deceived himself in his place? He saw his son lapsed to atheism, to the esprit, to the pleasant frivolity of clever Frenchmen. He saw in the background the great bloodsucker, the spider skepticism. He suspected the incurable wretchedness of a heart no longer hard enough either for evil or good, and of a broken will that no longer commands, is no longer able to command. Meanwhile, however, there grew up in his son that new kind of harder and more dangerous skepticism. Who knows to what extent it was encouraged just by his father's hatred and the icy melancholy of a will condemned to solitude? The skepticism of daring manliness, which is closely related to the genius for war and conquest, and made its first entrance into Germany in the person of the great Frederick. This skepticism despises and nevertheless grasps. It undermines and takes possession. It does not believe, but it does not thereby lose itself. It gives the spirit a dangerous liberty, but it keeps strict guard over the heart. It is the German form of skepticism, which, as a continued Frederickianism, risen to the highest spirituality, has kept Europe for a considerable time under the dominion of the German spirit and its critical and historical distrust. Owing to the insuperably strong and tough masculine character of the great German philologists and historical critics, who, rightly estimated, were also all of them artists of destruction and dissolution, a new conception of the German spirit gradually established itself, in spite of all romanticism in music and philosophy, in which the leaning towards masculine skepticism was decidedly prominent, whether, for instance, as fearlessness of gaze, as courage and sternness of the dissecting hand, or as resolute will to dangerous voyages of discovery, to spiritualized North Pole expeditions under barren and dangerous skies. There may be good grounds for it when warm-blooded and superficial humanitarians cross themselves before this spirit, c'est esprit fataliste, ironique, mephistophélique, as Michelet calls it, not without a shudder. But if one would realize how characteristic is this fear of the man in the German spirit which awakened Europe out of its dogmatic slumber, let us call to mind the former conception which had to be overcome by this new one, and that it is not so very long ago that a masculinized woman could dare, with unbridled presumption, to recommend the Germans to the interest of Europe as gentle, good-hearted, weak-willed, and poetical fools. Finally, let us only understand profoundly enough Napoleon's astonishment when he saw Goethe. It reveals what had been regarded for centuries as the German spirit. Voilà un homme! That was as much to say, but this is a man, and I only expected to see a German. 210. Supposing, then, that in the picture of the philosophers of the future, some trait suggests the question whether they must not perhaps be skeptics in the last-mentioned sense, something in them would only be designated thereby, and not they themselves. With equal right they might call themselves critics, and assuredly they will be men of experiments. By the name with which I ventured to baptize them, I have already expressly emphasized their attempting and their love of attempting. Is this because, as critics in body and soul, they will love to make use of experiments in a new and perhaps wider and more dangerous sense? In their passion for knowledge, will they have to go further in daring and painful attempts than the sensitive and pampered taste of a democratic century can approve of? There is no doubt these coming ones will be least able to dispense with the serious and not unscrupulous qualities which distinguish the critic from the skeptic. I mean the certainty as to standards of worth, the conscious employment of a unity of method, the wary courage, the standing alone, and the capacity for self-responsibility. Indeed, they will avow among themselves a delight in denial and dissection, and a certain considerate cruelty, which knows how to handle the knife surely and deftly, even when the heart bleeds. They will be sterner, and perhaps not always towards themselves only, than humane people may desire. They will not deal with the truth in order that it may please them, or elevate and inspire them. They will rather have little faith in truth, bringing with it such revels for the feelings. They will smile, those rigorous spirits, when anyone says in their presence, "That thought elevates me, why should it not be true?" or "That work enchants me, why should it not be beautiful?" or "That artist enlarges me, why should he not be great?" Perhaps they will not only have a smile, but a genuine disgust for all that is thus rapturous, idealistic, feminine, and hermaphroditic, and if any one could look into their inmost hearts, he would not easily find therein the intention to reconcile Christian sentiments with antique taste, or even with modern parliamentarism, the kind of reconciliation necessarily found even among philosophers in our very uncertain and consequently very conciliatory century. Critical discipline, and every habit that conduces to purity and rigor in intellectual matters, will not only be demanded from themselves by these philosophers of the future, they may even make a display thereof as their special adornment. Nevertheless, they will not want to be called critics on that account. It will seem to them no small indignity to philosophy to have it decreed, as is so welcome nowadays, that philosophy itself is criticism and critical science, and nothing else whatever. Though this estimate of philosophy may enjoy the approval of all the positivists of France and Germany, and possibly it even flattered the heart and taste of Kant, let us call to mind the titles of his principal works. Our new philosophers will say, notwithstanding, that critics are instruments of the philosopher, and just on that account, as instruments, they are far from being philosophers themselves. Even the great Chinaman of Königsberg was only a great critic. 211. I insist upon it that people finally cease confounding philosophical workers, and in general scientific men, with philosophers, that precisely here one should strictly give each his own, and not give those far too much, these far too little. It may be necessary for the education of the real philosopher that he himself should have once stood upon all those steps upon which his servants, the scientific workers of philosophy, remain standing, and must remain standing. He himself must perhaps have been critic, and dogmatist, and historian, and besides, poet, and collector, and traveller, and riddle-reader, and moralist, and seer, and free spirit, and almost everything, in order to traverse the whole range of human values and estimations, and that he may be able, with a variety of eyes and consciences, to look from a height to any distance, from a depth up to any height, from a nook into any expanse. But all these are only preliminary conditions for his task. This task itself demands something else. It requires him to create values. The philosophical workers, after the excellent pattern of Kant and Hegel, have to fix and formalize some great existing body of valuations, that is to say, former determinations of value, creations of value, which have become prevalent, and are for a time called truths, whether in the domain of the logical, the political, moral, or the artistic. It is for these investigators to make whatever has happened and been esteemed hitherto conspicuous, conceivable, intelligible, and manageable, to shorten everything long, even time itself, and to subjugate the entire past, an immense and wonderful task, in the carrying out of which all refined pride, all tenacious will, can surely find satisfaction. The real philosophers, however, are commanders and lawgivers. They say, "Thus shall it be." They determine first the whither and the why of mankind, and thereby set aside the previous labor of all philosophical workers, and all subjugators of the past. They grasp at the future with a creative hand, and whatever is and was becomes for them thereby a means, an instrument, and a hammer. Their knowing is creating. Their creating is a law-giving. Their will to truth is will to power. Are there at present such philosophers? Have there ever been such philosophers? Must there not be such philosophers some day? 212. It is always more obvious to me that the philosopher, as a man indispensable for the morrow and the day after the morrow, has ever found himself, and has been obliged to find himself, in contradiction to the day in which he lives. His enemy has always been the ideal of his day. Hitherto all those extraordinary furtherers of humanity whom one calls philosophers, who rarely regarded themselves as lovers of wisdom, but rather as disagreeable fools and dangerous interrogators, have found their mission, their hard, involuntary, imperative mission, in the end, however, the greatness of their mission, in being the bad conscience of their age, in putting the vivisector's knife to the breast of the very virtues of their age. They have betrayed their own secret. It has been for the sake of a new greatness of man, a new untrodden path to his aggrandizement. They have always disclosed how much hypocrisy, indolence, self-indulgence, and self-neglect, how much falsehood was concealed under the most venerated types of contemporary morality, how much virtue was outlived. They have always said, "We must remove hence to where you are least at home." In the face of a world of modern ideas, which would like to confine everyone in a corner, in a specialty, a philosopher, if there could be philosophers nowadays, would be compelled to place the greatness of man, the conception of greatness, precisely in his comprehensiveness and multifariousness, in his all-roundness. He would even determine worth and rank according to the amount and variety of that which a man could bear and take upon himself, according to the extent to which a man could stretch his responsibility. Nowadays, the taste and virtue of the age weaken and attenuate the will. Nothing is so adapted to the spirit of the age as weakness of will. Consequently, in the ideal of the philosopher, strength of will, sternness, and capacity for prolonged resolution must specially be included in the conception of greatness, with as good a right as the opposite doctrine, with its ideal of a silly, renouncing, humble, selfless humanity, was suited to an opposite age, such as the 16th century, which suffered from its accumulated energy of will, and from the wildest torrents and floods of selfishness. In the time of Socrates, among men only of worn-out instincts, old conservative Athenians who let themselves go, for the sake of happiness, as they said, for the sake of pleasure, as their conduct indicated, and who had continually on their lips the old pompous words to which they had long forfeited the right by the life they led, irony was perhaps necessary for greatness of soul, the wicked Socratic assurance of the old physician and plebeian, who cut ruthlessly into his own flesh, as into the flesh and heart of the noble, with a look that said plainly enough, "Do not dissemble before me. Here, we are equal." At present, on the contrary, when throughout Europe the herding animal alone attains to honors and dispenses honors, when equality of right can too readily be transformed into equality in wrong, I mean to say into general war against everything rare, strange, and privileged, against the higher man, the higher soul, the higher duty, the higher responsibility, the creative plenipotence and lordliness. At present it belongs to the conception of greatness to be noble, to wish to be apart, to be capable of being different, to stand alone, to have to live by personal initiative. And the philosopher will betray something of his own ideal when he asserts, "He shall be the greatest who can be the most solitary, the most concealed, the most divergent, the man beyond good and evil, the master of his virtues, and of superabundance of will. Precisely this shall be called greatness, as diversified as can be entire, as ample as can be full." And to ask once more the question, is greatness possible nowadays? 213. It is difficult to learn what a philosopher is, because it cannot be taught. One must know it by experience, or one should have the pride not to know it. The fact that at present people all talk of things of which they cannot have any experience is true more especially, and unfortunately, as concerns the philosopher and philosophical matters. The very few know them, are permitted to know them, and all popular ideas about them are false. Thus, for instance, the truly philosophical combination of a bold, exuberant spirituality, which runs at presto pace, and a dialectic rigor and necessity which makes no false step, is unknown to most thinkers and scholars from their own experience, and therefore, should anyone speak of it in their presence, it is incredible to them. They conceive of every necessity as troublesome, as a painful compulsory obedience and state of constraint. Thinking itself is regarded by them as something slow and hesitating, almost as a trouble, and often enough as worthy of the sweat of the noble, but not at all as something easy and divine, closely related to dancing and exuberance. To think, and to take a matter seriously, arduously, that is one and the same thing to them. Such only has been their experience. Artists have here perhaps a finer intuition, they who know only too well that precisely when they no longer do anything arbitrarily, and everything of necessity, their feeling of freedom, of subtlety, of power, of creatively fixing, disposing, and shaping, reaches its climax. In short, that necessity and freedom of will are then the same thing with them. There is, in fine, a graduation of rank in psychical states, to which the graduation of rank in the problems corresponds. and the highest problems repel ruthlessly every one who ventures too near them, without being predestined for their solution by the loftiness and power of his spirituality. Of what use is it for nimble everyday intellects, or clumsy honest mechanics and empiricists, to press, in their plebeian ambition, close to such problems, and as it were into this holy of holies, as so often happens nowadays? But coarse feet must never tread upon such carpets. This is provided for in the primary law of things. The doors remain closed to those intruders, though they may dash and break their heads thereon. People have always to be born to a high station, or, more definitely, they have to be bred for it. A person has only a right to philosophy, taking the word in its higher significance, in virtue of his descent. The ancestors, the blood, decide here also. Many generations must have prepared the way for the coming of the philosopher. Each of his virtues must have been separately acquired, nurtured, transmitted, and embodied. Not only the bold, easy, delicate course and current of his thoughts, but above all the readiness for great responsibilities, the majesty of ruling glance and contemning look, the feeling of separation from the multitude with their duties and virtues, the kindly patronage and defense of whatever is misunderstood and calumniated, be it God or devil, the delight and practice of supreme justice, the art of commanding, the amplitude of will, the lingering eye which rarely admires, rarely looks up, rarely loves. End of chapter 6. Read by Kara Schallenberg on January 8, 2006, in Oceanside, California.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This reading by Andrew Miller, Toronto, May 2006. Beyond Good and Evil by Friedrich Nietzsche. Translated by Helen Zimmern. Chapter 7. Our Virtues. 214. Our Virtues? It is probable that we, too, have still our virtues, although, naturally, they are not those sincere and massive virtues on account of which we hold our grandfathers in esteem, and also at a little distance from us. We Europeans of the day after tomorrow, we firstlings of the 20th century, with all our dangerous curiosity, our multifariousness and art of disguising, our mellow and seemingly sweetened cruelty in sense and spirit, we shall, presumably, if we must have virtues, have those only which have come to agreement with our most secret and heartfelt inclinations, with our most ardent requirements. Well, then, let us look for them in our labyrinths, where, as we know, so many things lose themselves, so many things get quite lost. And is there anything finer than to search for one's own virtues? Is it not almost to believe in one's own virtues? But this believing in one's own virtues, is it not practically the same as what was formerly called one's good conscience, that long, respectable pigtail of an idea, which our grandfathers used to hang behind their heads, and often enough also behind their understandings? It seems, therefore, that however little we may imagine ourselves to be old-fashioned and grandfatherly respectable in other respects, in one thing we are nevertheless the worthy grandchildren of our grandfathers, we last Europeans with good consciences. We also still wear the pigtail. Ah, if you only knew how soon, so very soon, it will be different. 215. As in the stellar firmament there are sometimes two suns which determine the path of one planet, and in certain cases suns of different colors shine around a single planet, now with red light, now with green, and then simultaneously illumine and flood it with motley colors, so we modern men, owing to the complicated mechanism of our firmament, are determined by different moralities. Our actions shine alternately in different colors, and are seldom unequivocal. And there are often cases, also, in which our actions are motley colored. 216. To love one's enemies? I think that has been well learnt. It takes place thousands of times at present, on a large and small scale. Indeed, at times the higher and sublimer thing takes place. We learn to despise when we love, and precisely when we love best. All of it, however, unconsciously, without noise, without ostentation, with the shame and secrecy of goodness, which forbids the utterance of the pompous word and the formula of virtue. Morality, as attitude, is opposed to our taste nowadays. This is also an advance, as it was an advance in our fathers, that religion as an attitude finally became opposed to their taste, including the enmity and Voltairean bitterness against religion, and all that formerly belonged to freethinker pantomime. It is the music in our conscience, the dance in our spirit, to which Puritan litanies, moral sermons, and goody-goodness won't chime. 217. Let us be careful in dealing with those who attach great importance to being credited with moral tact and subtlety and moral discernment. They never forgive us if they have once made a mistake before us, or even with regard to us. They inevitably become our instinctive calumniators and detractors, even when they still remain our friends. Blessed are the forgetful, for they get the better, even of their blunders. 218. The psychologists of France, and where else are there still psychologists nowadays, have never yet exhausted their bitter and manifold enjoyment of the petit bourgeois, just as though, in short, they betray something thereby. Flaubert, for instance, the honest citizen of Rouen, neither saw, heard, nor tasted anything else in the end. It was his mode of self-torment and refined cruelty. As this is growing wearisome, I would now recommend for a change something else for a pleasure, namely the unconscious astuteness with which good, fat, honest mediocrity always behaves towards loftier spirits and the tasks they have to perform, the subtle, barbed, Jesuitical astuteness, which is a thousand times subtler than the taste and understanding of the middle class in its best moments, subtler even than the understanding of its victims. A repeated proof that instinct is the most intelligent of all kinds of intelligence which have hitherto been discovered. In short, you psychologists, study the philosophy of the rule in its struggle with the exception. There you have a spectacle fit for gods and godlike malignity. Or, in plainer words, practice vivisection on good people, on the homo bonae voluntatis, on yourselves. 219. The practice of judging and condemning morally is the favorite revenge of the intellectually shallow on those who are less so. It is also a kind of indemnity for their being badly endowed by nature. And finally, it is an opportunity for acquiring spirit and becoming subtle. Malice spiritualise. They are glad in their inmost heart that there is a standard according to which those who are over-endowed with intellectual goods and privileges are equal to them. They contend for the equality of all before God, and almost need the belief in God for this purpose. It is among them that the most powerful antagonists of atheism are found. If anyone were to say to them, "A lofty spirituality is beyond all comparison with the honesty and respectability of a merely moral man," it would make them furious. I shall take care not to say so. I would rather flatter them with my theory that lofty spirituality itself exists only as the ultimate product of moral qualities, that it is a synthesis of all qualities attributed to the merely moral man, after they have been acquired singly through long training and practice, perhaps during a whole series of generations, that lofty spirituality is precisely the spiritualizing of justice and the beneficent severity which knows that it is authorized to maintain gradations of rank in the world, even among things, and not only among men. 220. Now that the praise of the disinterested person is so popular, one must, probably not without some danger, get an idea of what people actually take an interest in, and what are the things generally which fundamentally and profoundly concern ordinary men, including the cultured, even the learned, and perhaps philosophers also, if appearances do not deceive. The fact thereby becomes obvious that the greater part of what interests and charms higher natures and more refined and fastidious tastes seems absolutely uninteresting to the average man, if, notwithstanding, he perceived devotion to these interests. He calls it desinteresse, and wonders how it is possible to act disinterestedly. There have been philosophers who could give this popular astonishment a seductive and mystical, otherworldly expression, perhaps because they did not know the higher nature by experience. Instead of stating the naked and candidly reasonable truth that disinterested action is very interesting and interested action, provided that... And love? What? Even an action for love's sake shall be unegoistic. But you fools! And the praise of the self-sacrificer? But whoever has really offered sacrifice knows that he wanted and obtained something for it. Perhaps something from himself, for something from himself, that he relinquished here in order to have more there, perhaps in general to be more, or even feel himself more. But this is a realm of questions and answers in which a more fastidious spirit does not like to stay, for here truth has to stifle her yawns so much when she is obliged to answer. And, after all, truth is a woman. One must not use force with her. 221. "It sometimes happens," said a moralistic pedant and trifle retailer, "that I honor and respect an unselfish man. Not, however, because he is unselfish, but because I think he has a right to be useful to another man at his own expense." In short, the question is always who he is and who the other is. For instance, in a person created and destined for command, self-denial and modest retirement, instead of being virtues, would be the waste of virtues. So it seems to me. Every system of unegoistic morality, which takes itself unconditionally and appeals to everyone, not only sins against good taste, but is also an incentive to sins of omission, an additional seduction under the mask of philanthropy, and precisely a seduction and injury to the higher, rarer, and more privileged types of men. Moral systems must be compelled, first of all, to bow before the gradations of rank. Their presumption must be driven home to their conscience, until they thoroughly understand, at last, that it is immoral to say that what is right for one is proper for another. So said my moralistic pedant and bonhomme. Did he perhaps deserve to be laughed at when he thus exhorted systems of morals to practice morality? But one should not be too much in the right if one wishes to have the laughers on one's own side. A grain of wrong pertains even to good taste. 222. Wherever sympathy, fellow suffering, is preached nowadays, and, if I gather rightly, no other religion is any longer preached, let the psychologist have his ears open through all the vanity, through all the noise which is natural to these preachers, as to all preachers, he will hear a hoarse, groaning, genuine note of self-contempt. It belongs to the overshadowing and uglifying of Europe, which has been on the increase for a century, the first symptoms of which are already specified documentarily in a thoughtful letter of Galliani to Madame d'Epinay, if it is not really the cause thereof. The man of modern ideas, the conceited ape, is excessively dissatisfied with himself. This is perfectly certain. He suffers, and his vanity wants him only to suffer with his fellows. 223. The hybrid European, a tolerably ugly plebeian, taken all in all, absolutely requires a costume. He needs history as a storeroom of costumes. To be sure, he notices that none of the costumes fit him properly. He changes and changes. Let us look at the 19th century with respect to these hasty preferences and changes in its masquerades of style, and also with respect to its moments of desperation on account of nothing suiting us. It is in vain to get ourselves up as romantic, or classical, or Christian, or Florentine, or Barocco, or national in moribus et artibus. It does not clothe us. But the spirit, especially the historical spirit, profits even by this desperation. Once and again a new sample of the past or of the foreign is tested, put on, taken off, packed up, and above all, studied. We are the first studious age in puncto of costumes, I mean as concerns morals, articles of belief, artistic tastes, and religions. We are prepared, as no other age has ever been, for a carnival in the grand style, for the most spiritual festival, laughter and arrogance, for the transcendental height of supreme folly and Aristophanic ridicule of the world. Perhaps we are still discovering the domain of our invention just here, the domain where even we can still be original, probably as parodists of the world's history and as God's Merry Andrews. Perhaps, though nothing else of the present have a future, our laughter itself may have a future. 224. The historical sense, or the capacity for divining quickly the order of rank of the valuations according to which a people, a community, or an individual has lived, the divining instinct for the relationships of these valuations, for the relation of the authority of the valuations to the authority of the operating forces, this historical sense, which we Europeans claim as our own specialty, has come to us in the train of the enchanting and mad semi-barbarity into which Europe has been plunged by the democratic mingling of classes and races. It is only the 19th century that has recognized this faculty as its sixth sense. Owing to this mingling, the past of every form and mode of life, and of cultures which were formerly closely contiguous and superimposed on one another, flows forth into us modern souls. Our instincts now run back in all directions. We ourselves are a kind of chaos. In the end, as we have said, the spirit perceives its advantage therein. By means of our semi-barbarity in body and in desire, we have secret access everywhere, such as a noble age never had. We have access, above all, to the labyrinth of imperfect civilizations, and to every form of semi-barbarity that has at any time existed on earth. And in so far as the most considerable part of human civilization hitherto has just been semi-barbarity, the historical sense implies almost the sense and instinct for everything, the taste and tongue for everything, whereby it immediately proves itself to be an ignoble sense. For instance, we enjoy Homer once more. It is perhaps our happiest acquisition that we know how to appreciate Homer, whom men of distinguished culture, as the French of the 17th century, like Saint-Evremond, who reproached him for his esprit vaste, and even Voltaire, the last echo of the century, cannot and could not so easily appropriate, whom they scarcely permitted themselves to enjoy. The very decided yea and nay of their palate, their promptly ready disgust, their hesitating reluctance with regard to everything strange, their horror of the bad taste even of lively curiosity, and in general the averseness of every distinguished and self-sufficing culture to avow a new desire, a dissatisfaction with its own condition, or an admiration of what is strange, all this determines and disposes them unfavorably even towards the best things of the world which are not their property, or could not become their prey. And no faculty is more unintelligible to such men than just this historical sense, with its truckling, plebeian curiosity. The case is not different with Shakespeare, that marvelous Spanish, Moorish, Saxon synthesis of taste, over whom an ancient Athenian of the circle of Aeschylus would have half killed himself with laughter or irritation. But we accept precisely this wild motliness, this medley of the most delicate, the most coarse, and the most artificial, with a secret confidence and cordiality. We enjoy it as a refinement of art reserved expressly for us, and allow ourselves to be as little disturbed by the repulsive fumes and the proximity of the English populace in which Shakespeare's art and taste lives, as perhaps on the Chiaja of Naples, where, with all our senses awake, we go our way, enchanted and voluntarily, in spite of the drain odor of the lower quarters of the town. That as men of the historical sense we have our virtues is not to be disputed. We are unpretentious, unselfish, modest, brave, habituated to self-control and self-renunciation, very grateful, very patient, very complaisant. But with all this, we are perhaps not very tasteful. Let us finally confess it, that what is most difficult for us men of the historical sense to grasp, feel, taste, and love, what finds us fundamentally prejudiced and almost hostile, is precisely the perfection and ultimate maturity in every culture and art the essentially noble in works and men, their moment of smooth sea and halcyon self-sufficiency, the goldenness and coldness which all things show that have perfected themselves. Perhaps our great virtue of the historical sense is in necessary contrast to good taste, at least to the very bad taste, and we can only evoke in ourselves imperfectly, hesitatingly, and with compulsion the small, short, and happy godsends and glorifications of human life as they shine here and there. Those moments and marvelous experiences when a great power has voluntarily come to a halt before the boundless and infinite. When a superabundance of refined delight has been enjoyed by a sudden checking and petrifying, by standing firmly and planting oneself fixedly on still trembling ground. Proportionateness is strange to us. Let us confess it to ourselves. Our itching is really the itching for the infinite, the immeasurable. Like the rider on his forward panting horse, we let the reins fall before the infinite, we modern men, we semi-barbarians, and are only in our highest bliss when we are in the most danger. 225. Whether it be hedonism, pessimism, utilitarianism, or eudaimonism, all those modes of thinking which measure the worth of things according to pleasure and pain, that is, according to accompanying circumstances and secondary considerations, are plausible modes of thought and naivetés which everyone conscious of creative powers and an artist's conscience will look down upon with scorn, though not without sympathy. Sympathy for you? To be sure, that is not sympathy as you understand it. It is not sympathy for social distress, for society with its sick and misfortuned, for the hereditarily vicious and defective who lie in the ground around us. Still less is it sympathy for the grumbling, vexed, revolutionary slave classes who strive after power. They call it freedom. Our sympathy is a loftier and further-sighted sympathy. We see how man dwarfs himself, how you dwarf him. And there are moments when we view your sympathy with an indescribable anguish, when we resist it, when we regard your seriousness as more dangerous than any kind of levity. You want, if possible, and there is not a more foolish, if possible, to do away with suffering. And we, it really seems that we would rather have it increased and made worse than it has ever been. Well-being, as you understand it, is certainly not a goal. It seems to us an end, a condition which at once renders man ludicrous and contemptible, and makes his destruction desirable. The discipline of suffering, of great suffering. Know ye not that it is only this discipline that has produced all the elevations of humanity hitherto? The tension of soul in misfortune, which communicates to it its energy, its shuddering in view of rack and ruin, its inventiveness and bravery in undergoing, enduring, interpreting, and exploiting misfortune. And whatever depth, mystery, disguise, spirit, artifice, or greatness has been bestowed upon the soul, has it not been bestowed through suffering, through the discipline of great suffering? In man, creature and creator are united. In man there is not only matter, shred, excess, clay, mire, folly, chaos, but there is also the creator, the sculptor, the hardness of the hammer, the divinity of the spectator, and the seventh day. Do ye understand this contrast? And that your sympathy for the creature in man applies to that which has to be fashioned, bruised, forged, stretched, roasted, annealed, refined, to that which must necessarily suffer, and is meant to suffer. And our sympathy, do ye not understand what our reverse sympathy applies to, when it resists your sympathy as the worst of all pampering and enervation? So it is sympathy against sympathy. But, to repeat it once more, there are higher problems than the problems of pleasure and pain and sympathy, and all systems of philosophy which deal only with these are naivetes. 226. We immoralists. This world with which we are concerned, in which we have to fear and love, this almost invisible, inaudible world of delicate command and delicate obedience, a world of almost, in every respect, captious, insidious, sharp, and tender. Yes, it is well protected from clumsy spectators and familiar curiosity. We are woven into a strong net and garment of duties, and cannot disengage ourselves. Precisely here we are men of duty, even we. Occasionally, it is true, we dance in our chains and betwixt our swords. It is nonetheless true that more often we gnash our teeth under the circumstances and are impatient at the secret hardship of our lot. But do what we will, fools and appearances say of us, these are men without duty. We have always fools and appearances against us. 227. Honesty, granting that it is the virtue of which we cannot rid ourselves, we free spirits, well, we will labor at it with all our perversity and love, and not tire of perfecting ourselves in our virtue, which alone remains. May its glance some day overspread like a gilded, blue, mocking twilight, this aging civilization, with its dull, gloomy seriousness. And if, nevertheless, our honesty should one day grow weary, and sigh, and stretch its limbs, and find us too hard, and would fain have it pleasanter, easier, and gentler, like an agreeable vice, let us remain hard, we latest Stoics, and let us send to its help whatever devilry we have in us, our disgust at the clumsy and undefined, our nitimur invititum, our love of adventure, our sharpened and fastidious curiosity, our most subtle, disguised, intellectual will to power and universal conquest, which rambles and roves avidiously around all the realms of the future. Let us go, with all our devils, to the help of our God. It is probable that people will misunderstand and mistake us on that account. What does it matter? They will say, their honesty, that is their devilry, and nothing else. What does it matter? And even if they were right, have not all gods hitherto been such sanctified, rebaptized devils? And after all, what do we know of ourselves? And what the spirit that leads us wants to be called? It is a question of names. And how many spirits we harbor? Our honesty, we free spirits, let us be careful lest it become our vanity, our ornament and ostentation, our limitation, our stupidity. Every virtue inclines to stupidity, every stupidity to virtue. Stupid to the point of sanctity, they say in Russia. Let us be careful lest, out of pure honesty, we eventually become saints and bores. Is not life 100 times too short for us to bore ourselves? One would have to believe in eternal life in order to. 228. I hope to be forgiven for discovering that all moral philosophy hitherto has been tedious and has belonged to the soporific appliances, and that virtue, in my opinion, has been more injured by the tediousness of its advocates than by anything else. At the same time, however, I would not wish to overlook their general usefulness. It is desirable that as few people as possible should reflect upon morals, and consequently it is very desirable that morals should not someday become interesting. But let us not be afraid. Things still remain today as they have always been. I see no one in Europe who has, or discloses, an idea of the fact that philosophizing concerning morals might be conducted in a dangerous, captious, and ensnaring manner, that calamity might be involved therein. Observe, for example, the indefatigable, inevitable English utilitarians, how ponderously and respectably they stalk on, stalk along, a Homeric metaphor expresses it better, in the footsteps of Bentham, just as he had already stalked in the footsteps of the respectable Helvetius. No, he was not a dangerous man, Helvetius, ce senateur poco courant, to use an expression of Galliani. No new thought, nothing of the nature of a finer turning or better expression of an old thought, not even a proper history of what has been previously thought on the subject, an impossible literature, taking it all in all, unless one knows how to leaven it with some mischief. In effect, the old English vice called cant, which is moral Tartuffism, has insinuated itself also into these moralists, whom one must certainly read with an eye to their motives, if one must read them. Concealed this time under the new form of the scientific spirit. Moreover, there is not absent from them a secret struggle with the pangs of conscience, from which a race of former Puritans must naturally suffer in all their scientific tinkering with morals. Is not a moralist the opposite of a Puritan? That is to say, as a thinker who regards morality as questionable, as worthy of interrogation, in short, as a problem, is moralizing not immoral? In the end, they all want English morality to be recognized as authoritative, inasmuch as mankind, or the general utility, or the happiness of the greatest number, no, the happiness of England, will be best served thereby. They would like, by all means, to convince themselves that the striving after English happiness, I mean after comfort and fashion, and, in the highest instance, a seat in Parliament, is at the same time the true path of virtue. In fact, that insofar as there has been virtue in the world hitherto, it has just consisted in such striving. Not one of those ponderous, conscience-stricken herding animals who undertake to advocate the cause of egoism as conducive to the general welfare wants to have any knowledge or inkling of the facts that the general welfare is no ideal, no goal, no notion that can be at all grasped, but is only a nostrum, that what is fair to one may not at all be fair to another, that the requirement of one morality for all is really a detriment to higher men. In short, that there is a distinction of rank between man and man, and consequently between morality and morality. They are an unassuming and fundamentally mediocre species of men, these utilitarian Englishmen, and, as already remarked, insofar as they are tedious, one cannot think highly enough of their utility. One ought even to encourage them, as has been partially attempted in the following rhymes. Hail, ye worthies, barrow wheeling, longer, better, eye revealing, stiffer eye in head and knee, unenraptured, never jesting, mediocre, everlasting, sans génie et sans esprit. In these later ages, which may be proud of their humanity, there still remains so much fear, so much superstition of the fear, of the cruel wild beast, the mastering of which constitutes the very pride of these humaner ages, that even obvious truths, as if by the agreement of centuries, have long remained unuttered, because they have the appearance of helping the finally slain wild beast back to life again. I perhaps risk something when I allow such a truth to escape. Let others capture it again, and give it so much milk of pious sentiment. Footnote: an expression from Schiller's William Tell, Act 4, Scene 3. Let others capture it again and give it so much milk of pious sentiment to drink that it will lie down quiet and forgotten in its old corner. One ought to learn anew about cruelty and open one's eyes. One ought at last to learn impatience in order that such immodest gross errors, as, for instance, have been fostered by ancient and modern philosophers with regard to tragedy, may no longer wander about virtuously and boldly. Almost everything that we call higher culture is based upon the spiritualizing and intensifying of cruelty. This is my thesis. The wild beast has not been slain at all. It lives. It flourishes. It has only been transfigured. That which constitutes the painful delight of tragedy is cruelty. That which operates agreeably in so-called tragic sympathy, and at the basis even of everything sublime, up to the highest and most delicate thrills of metaphysics, obtains its sweetness solely from the intermingled ingredient of cruelty. What the Roman enjoys in the arena, the Christian in the ecstasies of the cross, the Spaniard at the sight of the faggot and stake, or of the bullfight, the present-day Japanese who presses his way to the tragedy, the workman of the Parisian suburbs who has a homesickness for bloody revolutions, the Wagnerian who, with unhinged will, undergoes the performance of Tristan and Isolde. What all these enjoy, and strive with mysterious ardor to drink in, is the filter of the great Circe, cruelty. Here, to be sure, we must put aside entirely the blundering psychology of former times, which could only teach with regard to cruelty that originated at the sight of the suffering of others. There is an abundant, superabundant enjoyment even, in one's own suffering, in causing one's own suffering. And wherever man has allowed himself to be persuaded to self-denial in the religious sense, or to self-mutilation, as among the Phoenicians and ascetics, or in general, to desensualization, decarnalization, and contrition, to puritanical repentance spasms, to vivisection of conscience, and to Pascal-like sacrificia dell'intelletto, he is secretly allured and impelled forwards by his cruelty, by the dangerous thrill of cruelty towards himself. Finally, let us consider that even the seeker of knowledge operates as an artist and glorifier of cruelty, and that he compels his spirit to perceive against its own inclination, and often enough, against the wishes of his heart. He forces it to say nay, where he would like to affirm, love, and adore. Indeed, every instance of taking a thing profoundly and fundamentally is a violation, an intentional injuring of the fundamental will of the spirit, which instinctively aims at appearance and superficiality. Even in every desire for knowledge, there is a drop of cruelty. 230. Perhaps what I have said here about a fundamental will of the spirit may not be understood without further details. I may be allowed a word of explanation. That imperious something, which is popularly called the spirit, wishes to be master internally and externally, and to feel itself master. It has the will of a multiplicity for a simplicity, a binding, taming, imperious, and essentially ruling will. Its requirements and capacities here are the same as those assigned by physiologists to everything that lives, grows, and multiplies. The power of the spirit to appropriate foreign elements reveals itself in a strong tendency to assimilate the new to the old, to simplify the manifold, to overlook or repudiate the absolutely contradictory. Just as it arbitrarily re-underlines, makes prominent, and falsifies for itself certain traits and lines in the foreign elements in every portion of the outside world. Its object thereby is the incorporation of new experiences, the assortment of new things in the old arrangements, in short, growth, or, more properly, the feeling of growth, the feeling of increased power is its object. This same will has at its service an apparently opposed impulse of the spirit, a suddenly adopted preference of ignorance, of arbitrary shutting out, a closing of windows, an inner denial of this or that, a prohibition to approach, a sort of defensive attitude against much that is knowable, a contentment with obscurity, with the shutting in horizon, an acceptance and approval of ignorance, as that which is all necessary according to the degree of its appropriating power, its digestive power, to speak figuratively. And in fact, the spirit resembles a stomach more than anything else. Here also belong an occasional propensity of the spirit to let itself be deceived, perhaps with a waggish suspicion that it is not so-and-so, but is only allowed to pass as such. A delight in uncertainty, an ambiguity, an exulting enjoyment of arbitrary, out-of-the-way narrowness and mystery, of the too near, of the foreground, of the magnified, the diminished, the misshapen, the beautified, an enjoyment of the arbitrariness of all these manifestations of power. Finally, in this connection, there is the not unscrupulous readiness of the spirit to deceive other spirits and dissemble before them, the constant pressing and straining of a creating, shaping, changeable power. The spirit enjoys therein its craftiness and its variety of disguises. It enjoys also its feeling of security therein. It is precisely by its protean arts that it is best protected and concealed. Counter to this propensity for appearance, for simplification, for a disguise, for a cloak, in short, for an outside, for every outside is a cloak, there operates the sublime tendency of the man of knowledge, which takes and insists on taking things profoundly, variously, and thoroughly, as a kind of cruelty of the intellectual conscience and taste, which every courageous thinker will acknowledge in himself, provided, as it ought to be, that he has sharpened and hardened his eye sufficiently long for introspection, and is accustomed to severe discipline, and even severe words. He will say, "There is something cruel in the tendency of my spirit. Let the virtuous and amiable try to convince him that it is not so." In fact, it would sound nicer if, instead of our cruelty, perhaps our extravagant honesty were talked about, whispered about, and glorified. We free, very free spirits, and someday perhaps such will actually be our posthumous glory. Meanwhile, for there is plenty of time until then, we should be least inclined to deck ourselves out in such florid and fringed moral verbiage. Our whole former work has just made us sick of this taste and its sprightly exuberance. They are beautiful, glistening, jingling, festive words. Honesty, love of truth, love of wisdom, sacrifice for knowledge, heroism of the truthful. There is something in them that makes one's heart swell with pride. But we anchorites and marmots have long ago persuaded ourselves, in all the secrecy of an anchorite's conscience, that this worthy parade of verbiage also belongs to the old false adornment, frippery, and gold dust of unconscious human vanity, and that even under such flattering color and repainting, the terrible original text, Homo Natura, must again be recognized. In effect, to translate man back again into nature, to master the many vain and visionary interpretations and subordinate meanings which have hitherto been scratched and daubed over the eternal original text, Homo Natura, to bring it about that man shall henceforth stand before man as he now, hardened by the discipline of science, stands before the other forms of nature, with fearless Oedipus eyes and stopped Ulysses ears, deaf to the enticements of old metaphysical bird catchers who have piped to him far too long, "Thou art more, thou art higher, thou hast a different origin." This may be a strange and foolish task, but that it is a task, who can deny? Why did we choose it, this foolish task? Or, to put the question differently, why knowledge at all? Everyone will ask us about this. And thus pressed, we, who have asked ourselves the question 100 times, have not found and cannot find any better answer. Learning alters us. It does what all nourishment does that does not merely conserve, as the physiologist knows. But at the bottom of our souls, quite down below, there is certainly something unteachable, a granite of spiritual fate, of predetermined decision, an answer to predetermined chosen questions. In each cardinal problem there speaks an unchangeable "I am this." A thinker cannot learn anew about man and woman, for instance, but can only learn fully. He can only follow to the end what is fixed about them in himself. Occasionally, we find certain solutions of problems which make strong beliefs for us. Perhaps they are henceforth called convictions. Later on, one sees in them only footsteps to self-knowledge, guideposts to the problem which we ourselves are, or more correctly, to the great stupidity which we embody, our spiritual fate, the unteachable in us, quite down below. In view of this liberal compliment which I have just paid myself, permission will perhaps be more readily allowed me to utter some truths about woman as she is, provided that it is known at the outset how literally they are merely my truths. 232. Woman wishes to be independent, and therefore she begins to enlighten men about woman as she is. This is one of the worst developments of the general uglifying of Europe. For what must these clumsy attempts of feminine scientificality and self-exposure bring to light? Woman has so much cause for shame. In woman there is so much pedantry, superficiality, schoolmasterliness, petty presumption, unbridledness, and indiscretion concealed. Study only women's behavior towards children, which has really been best restrained and dominated hitherto by the fear of man. Alas, if ever the eternally tedious in woman, she has plenty of it, is allowed to venture forth, if she begins radically and on principle to unlearn her wisdom and art of charming, of playing, of frightening away sorrow, of alleviating and taking easily, if she forgets her delicate aptitude for agreeable desires, female voices are already raised, which, by St. Aristophanes, make one afraid. With medical explicitness it is stated in a threatening manner what woman first and last requires from man. Is it not in the very worst taste that woman sets herself up to be scientific? Enlightenment, hitherto, has fortunately been men's affair, men's gift. We've remained therewith among ourselves, and in the end, in view of all that women write about woman, we may well have considerable doubt as to whether woman really desires enlightenment about herself, and can desire it. If woman does not thereby seek a new ornament for herself, I believe ornamentation belongs to the eternally feminine, why then she wishes to make herself feared. Perhaps she thereby wishes to get the mastery. But she does not want truth. What does woman care for truth? From the very first, nothing is more foreign, more repugnant, or more hostile to woman than truth. Her great art is falsehood. Her chief concern is appearance and beauty. Let us confess it, we men. We honor and love this very art and this very instinct in woman. We who have the hard task, and for our recreation gladly seek the company of beings under whose hands, glances, and delicate follies, our seriousness, our gravity, and profundity appear almost like follies to us. Finally, I ask the question, did a woman herself ever acknowledge profundity in a woman's mind, or justice in a woman's heart? And is it not true that, on the whole, woman has hitherto been most despised by woman herself, and not at all by us? We men desire that woman should not continue to compromise herself by enlightening us, just as it was man's care and the consideration for woman when the Church decreed, "Mulier taceat in ecclesia." It was to the benefit of woman when Napoleon gave the too eloquent Madame de Staël to understand, "Mulier taceat in politicis." And in my opinion, he is a true friend of woman who calls out to woman today, "Mulier taceat de mulierel." 233. It betrays corruption of the instincts, apart from the fact that it betrays bad taste, when a woman refers to Madame Roland, or Madame de Staël, or Monsieur Georges Sand, as though something was proved thereby in favor of woman as she is. Among men, these are the three comical women as they are, nothing more, and just the best involuntary counter-argument against feminine emancipation and autonomy. 234. Stupidity in the kitchen, woman as cook, the terrible thoughtlessness with which the feeding of the family and the master of the house is managed. Woman does not understand what food means, and she insists on being cook. If woman had been a thinking creature, she should certainly, as cook for thousands of years, have discovered the most important physiological facts, and should likewise have got possession of the healing art. Through bad female cooks, through the entire lack of reason in the kitchen, the development of mankind has been longest retarded and most interfered with. Even today matters are very little better. A word to high school girls. 235. There are turns and casts of fancy, there are sentences, little handfuls of words, in which a whole culture, a whole society suddenly crystallizes itself. Among these is the incidental remark of Madame de Lambert to her son, "Mon ami, ne vous permettez jamais que des folies que vous feront grand plaisir." The motherliest and wisest remark, by the way, that was ever addressed to a son. 236. I have no doubt that every noble woman will oppose what Dante and Goethe believed about woman. The former, when he sang, "Ella guardava susso, ed io in lei," and the latter, when he interpreted it, "The eternally feminine draws us aloft." For this is just what she believes of the eternally masculine. 237. Seven apothegms for women. How the longest ennui flees when a man comes to our knees. Age, alas, and science stayed furnish even weak virtue aid. Sombre garb and silence meet, dress for every dame discreet. Whom I thank when in my bliss? God and my good tailoress. Young, a flower-decked cavern home. Old, a dragon thence doth roam. Noble title, leg that's fine, man as well, oh, were he mine. Speech in brief and sense in mass, slippery for the jenny ass. 237a. Woman has hitherto been treated by men like birds, which, losing their way, have come down among them from an elevation, as something delicate, fragile, wild, strange, sweet, and animating, but as something also which must be cooped up to prevent it flying away. 238. To be mistaken in the fundamental problem of man and woman, to deny here the profoundest antagonism and the necessity for an eternally hostile tension, to dream here, perhaps, of equal rights, equal training, equal claims and obligations, that is a typical sign of shallow-mindedness, and a thinker who has proved himself shallow at this dangerous spot, shallow in instinct, may generally be regarded as suspicious, nay more, as betrayed, as discovered. He will probably prove too short for all fundamental questions of life, future as well as present, and will be unable to descend into any of the depths. On the other hand, a man who has depth of spirit as well as of desires, and has also the depth of benevolence which is capable of severity and harshness, and easily confounded with them, can only think of woman as Orientals do. He must conceive of her as a possession, as confinable property, as being predestined for service and accomplishing her mission therein. He must take his stand in this matter upon the immense rationality of Asia, upon the superiority of the instinct of Asia, as the Greeks did formerly, those best heirs and scholars of Asia, who, as is well known, with their increasing culture and amplitude of power, from Homer to the time of Pericles, became gradually stricter towards woman, in short, more Oriental. How necessary, how logical, even how humanely desirable this was, let us consider for ourselves. 239. The weaker sex has in no previous age been treated with so much respect by men as at present. This belongs to the tendency and fundamental taste of democracy, in the same way as disrespectfulness to old age. What wonder is it that abuse should be immediately made of this respect? They want more, they learn to make claims, the tribute of respect is at last felt to be well-nigh galling. Rivalry for rights, indeed, actual strife itself, would be preferred. In a word, woman is losing modesty. And let us immediately add that she is also losing taste. She is unlearning to fear man. But the woman who unlearns to fear sacrifices her most womanly instincts. That woman should venture forward when the fear-inspiring quality in man, or more definitely, the man in man, is no longer either desired or fully developed, is reasonable enough and also intelligible enough. What is more difficult to understand is that precisely thereby, woman deteriorates. This is what is happening nowadays. Let us not deceive ourselves about it. Wherever the industrial spirit has triumphed over the military and aristocratic spirit, woman strives for the economic and legal independence of a clerk. Woman, as clerkess, is inscribed on the portal of the modern society which is in the course of formation. While she thus appropriates new rights, aspires to be master, and inscribes progress of woman on her flags and banners, the very opposite realizes itself with terrible obviousness. Woman retrogrades. Since the French Revolution, the influence of woman in Europe has declined in proportion as she has increased her rights and claims. And the emancipation of woman, insofar as it is desired and demanded by women themselves, and not only by masculine shallowpates, this proves to be a remarkable symptom of the increasing weakening and deadening of the most womanly instincts. There is stupidity in this movement, an almost masculine stupidity, of which a well-reared woman, who is always a sensible woman, might be heartily ashamed. To lose the intuition as to the ground upon which she can most surely achieve victory, to neglect exercise in the use of her proper weapons, to let herself go before man, perhaps even to the book, where formerly she kept herself in control and in refined, artful humility, to neutralize with her virtuous audacity man's faith in a veiled, fundamentally different ideal in woman, something eternally, necessarily feminine, to emphatically and loquaciously dissuade man from the idea that woman must be preserved, cared for, protected, and indulged, like some delicate, strangely wild, and often pleasant domestic animal. The clumsy and indignant collection of everything of the nature of servitude and bondage, which the position of woman in the hitherto existing order of society has entailed, and still entails, as though slavery were a counter-argument, and not rather a condition of every higher culture, of every elevation of culture. What does all this betoken, if not a disintegration of womanly instincts, a defeminizing? Certainly there are enough of idiotic friends and corruptors of woman among the learned asses of the masculine sex, who advise woman to defeminize herself in this manner, and to imitate all the stupidities from which man in Europe, European manliness, suffers, who would like to lower woman to general culture, indeed even to newspaper reading and meddling with politics. Here and there they wish even to make women into free spirits and literary workers, as though a woman without piety would not be something perfectly obnoxious or ludicrous to a profound and godless man. Almost everywhere her nerves are being ruined by the most morbid and dangerous kind of music, our latest German music, and she is daily being made more hysterical and more incapable of fulfilling her first and last function, that of bearing robust children. They wish to cultivate her in general still more, and intend, as they say, to make the weaker sex strong by culture, as if history did not teach in the most emphatic manner that the cultivating of mankind and his weakening that is to say, the weakening, dissipating, and languishing of his force of will, have always kept pace with one another, and that the most powerful and influential women in the world, and lastly, the mother of Napoleon, had just to thank their force of will, and not their schoolmasters, for their power and ascendancy over men. That which inspires respect in woman, and often enough fear also, is her nature, which is more natural than that of man, her genuine, carnivora-like, cunning flexibility, her tiger claws beneath the glove, her naivete and egoism, her untrainableness and innate wildness, the incomprehensibleness, extent, and deviation of her desires and virtues. That which, in spite of fear, excites one's sympathy for the dangerous and beautiful cat, woman, is that she seems more afflicted, more vulnerable, more necessitous of love, and more condemned to disillusionment than any other creature. Fear and sympathy it is with these feelings that man has hitherto stood in the presence of woman, always with one foot already in tragedy, which rends while it delights. What? And all that is now to be at an end? And the disenchantment of woman is in progress? The tediousness of woman is slowly evolving? Oh, Europe, Europe, we know the horned animal which was always most attractive to thee, from which danger is ever again threatening thee. Thy old fable might once more become history, and immense stupidity might once again overmaster thee and carry thee away, and no god concealed beneath it, no, only an idea, a modern idea. End of chapter 7.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recorded by Gesine. Beyond Good and Evil by Friedrich Nietzsche. Translated by Helen Zimmern. Chapter 8. Peoples and Countries. 240. I heard, once again for the first time, Richard Wagner's overture to the Master Singer. It is a piece of magnificent, gorgeous, heavy, latter-day art, which has the pride to presuppose 2 centuries of music as still living, in order that it may be understood. It is an honour to Germans that such a pride did not miscalculate. What flavours and forces, what seasons and climes do we not find mingled in it? It impresses us at one time as ancient, at another time as foreign, bitter, and too modern. It is as arbitrary as it is pompously traditional. It is not infrequently roguish, still oftener rough and coarse. It has fire and courage, and at the same time the loose, dun-coloured skin of fruits which ripen too late. It flows broad and full, and suddenly there is a moment of inexplicable hesitation, like a gap that opens between cause and effect, an oppression that makes us dream, almost a nightmare. But already it broadens and widens anew, the old stream of delight, the most manifold delight, of old and new happiness, including especially the joy of the artist in himself, which he refuses to conceal, his astonished, happy cognizance of his mastery of the expedients here employed, the new, newly acquired, imperfectly tested expedients of art, which he apparently betrays to us. All in all, however, no beauty, no south, nothing of the delicate southern clearness of the sky, nothing of grace, no dance, hardly a will to logic, a certain clumsiness even. which is also emphasized, as though the artist wishes to say to us, "It is part of my intention." A cumbersome drapery, something arbitrarily barbaric and ceremonious, a flaring of learned and venerable conceits and witticisms, something German in the best and worst sense of the word, something in the German style, manifold, formless, and inexhaustible, a certain German potency and superplenitude of soul, which is not afraid to hide itself under the raffinements of decadence, which perhaps feels itself more at ease there, a real, genuine token of the German soul, which is at the same time young and aged, too ripe and yet still too rich in futurity. This kind of music expresses best what I think of the Germans. They belong to the day before yesterday and the day after tomorrow. They have, as yet, no today. 241. We good Europeans, we also have hours when we allow ourselves a warm-hearted patriotism, a plunge and relapse into old loves and narrow views. I have just given an example of it. Hours of national excitement, of patriotic anguish, and all other sorts of old-fashioned floods of sentiment. Duller spirits may perhaps only get done with what confines its operations in us to hours and plays itself out in hours, in a considerable time, some in half a year, others in half a lifetime, according to the speed and strength with which they digest and change their material. Indeed, I could think of sluggish, hesitating races, which even in our rapidly moving Europe would require half a century ere they could surmount such atavistic attacks of patriotism and soil attachment, and return once more to reason, that is to say, to good Europeanism. And while digressing on this possibility, I happened to become an ear witness of a conversation between two old patriots. They were evidently both hard of hearing, and consequently spoke all the louder. "He has as much, and knows as much, philosophy as a peasant or a corps student," said the one. "He is still innocent. But what does that matter nowadays? It is the age of the masses. They lie on their belly before everything that is massive. And so also in politics. A statesman who rears up for them a new Tower of Babel, some monstrosity of empire and power, they call great. What does it matter that we more prudent and conservative ones do not meanwhile give up the old belief that it is only the great thought that gives greatness to an action or affair? Supposing a statesman were to bring his people into the position of being obliged henceforth to practice high politics, for which they were by nature badly endowed and prepared, so that they would have to sacrifice their old and reliable virtues out of love to a new and doubtful mediocrity. Supposing a statesman were to condemn his people generally to practice politics, when they have hitherto had something better to do and think about, and when in the depths of their souls they have been unable to free themselves from a prudent loathing of the restlessness, emptiness and noisy wranglings of the essentially politics-practicing nations. Supposing such a statesman were to stimulate the slumbering passions and avidities of his people, were to make a stigma out of their former diffidence and delight in aloofness, an offence out of their exoticism and hidden permanency, were to depreciate their most radical proclivities, subvert their consciences, make their minds narrow and their tastes national. What? A statesman who should do all this, which his people would have to do penance for throughout their whole future, if they had a future, such a statesman would be great, would he? Undoubtedly, replied the other old patriot vehemently. Otherwise he could not have done it. It was mad, perhaps, to wish such a thing, but perhaps everything great has been just as mad as its commencement. Misuse of words, cried his interlocutor, contradictorily. Strong, strong, strong and mad, not great. The old men had obviously become heated as they thus shouted their truths in each other's faces, but I, in my happiness and apartness, considered how soon a stronger one may become master of the strong, and also that there is a compensation for the intellectual superficializing of a nation, namely, in the deepening of another. 242. Whether we call it civilization, or humanizing, or progress, which now distinguishes the European, whether we call it simply, without praise or blame, by the political formula, the democratic movement in Europe, behind all the moral and political foregrounds pointed to by such formulas, an immense physiological process goes on, which is ever extending the process of the assimilation of Europeans, their increasing detachment from the conditions under which, climatically and hereditarily, united races originate, their increasing independence of every definite milieu, that for centuries would fain inscribe itself with equal demands on soul and body, that is to say, the slow emergence of an essentially supranational and nomadic species of man, who possesses, physiologically speaking, a maximum of the art and power of adaptation as his typical distinction. This process of the evolving European, which can be retarded in its tempo by great relapses, but will perhaps just gain and grow thereby in vehemence and depth, the still raging storm and stress of national sentiment pertains to it, and also the anarchism which is appearing at present. This process will probably arrive at results on which its naive propagators and panegyrists, the apostles of modern ideas, would least care to reckon. The same new conditions under which, on an average, a levelling and mediocrising of man will take place. A useful, industrious, variously serviceable, and clever, gregarious man are in the highest degree suitable to give rise to exceptional men of the most dangerous and attractive qualities. For while the capacity for adaptation, which is every day changing conditions, and begins a new work with every generation, almost with every decade, makes the powerfulness of the type impossible, while the collective impression of such future Europeans will probably be that of numerous talkative, weak-willed, and very handy workmen who require a master, a commander, as they require their daily bread. While, therefore, the democratizing of Europe will tend to the production of a type prepared for slavery in the most subtle sense of the term, the strong man will necessarily, in individual and exceptional cases, become stronger and richer than he has perhaps ever been before. Owing to the unprejudicedness of his schooling, owing to the immense variety of practice, art, and disguise. I meant to say that the democratizing of Europe is at the same time an involuntary arrangement for the rearing of tyrants, taking the word in all its meanings, even in its most spiritual sense. 243. I hear with pleasure that our sun is moving rapidly towards the constellation Hercules, and I hope that the men on this earth will do like the sun. And we foremost, we good Europeans. 244. There was a time when it was customary to call Germans deep by way of distinction, but now that the most successful type of new Germanism is covetous of quite other honours, and perhaps misses smartness in all that has depth, it is almost opportune and patriotic to doubt whether we did not formerly deceive ourselves with that commendation. In short, whether German depth is not at bottom something different and worse, and something from which, thank God, we are on the point of successfully ridding ourselves. Let us try, then, to relearn with regard to German depth. The only thing necessary for the purpose is a little vivisection of the German soul. The German soul is above all manifold, varied in its source, aggregated and superimposed, rather than actually built. This is owing to its origin. A German who would embolden himself to assert, "Two souls, alas, dwell in my breast," would make a bad guess at the truth, or, more correctly, he would come far short of the truth about the number of souls. As a people made up of the most extraordinary mixing and mingling of races, perhaps even with a preponderance of the pre-Aryan element, as the people of the centre, in every sense of the term, the Germans are more intangible, more ample, more contradictory, more unknown, more incalculable, more surprising, and even more terrifying than other people are to themselves. They escape definition, and are thereby alone the despair of the French. It is characteristic of the Germans that the question, "What is German?" never dies out among them. Kotzebue certainly knew his Germans well enough. "We are known," they cried jubilantly to him. But Zand also thought he knew them. Jean-Paul knew what he was doing when he declared himself incensed at Fichte's lying but patriotic flatteries and exaggerations. But it is probable that Goethe thought differently about Germans from Jean-Paul, even though he acknowledged him to be right with regard to Fichte. It is a question what Goethe really thought about the Germans. But about many things around him he never spoke explicitly, and all his life he knew how to keep an astute silence. Probably he had good reason for it. It is certain that it was not the Wars of Independence that made him look up more joyfully, any more than it was the French Revolution. The event on account of which he reconstructed his Faust, and indeed the whole problem of man, was the appearance of Napoleon. There are words of Goethe in which he condemns with impatient severity, as from a foreign land, that which Germans take pride in. He once defined the famous German turn of mind as indulgence towards its own and others' weaknesses. Was he wrong? It is characteristic of Germans that one is seldom entirely wrong about them. The German soul has passages and galleries in it. There are caves, hiding places, and dungeons therein. Its disorder has much of the charm of the mysterious. The German is well acquainted with the bypaths to chaos. And as everything loves its symbol, so the German loves the clouds and all that is obscure, evolving, crepuscular, damp, and shrouded. It seems to him that everything uncertain, undeveloped, self-displacing, and growing is deep. The German himself does not exist. He is becoming. He is developing himself. Development is therefore the essentially German discovery, and hit in the great domain of philosophical formulas, a ruling idea which, together with German beer and German music, is laboring to Germanize all Europe. Foreigners are astonished and attracted by the riddles which the conflicting nature at the basis of the German soul propounds to them, riddles which Hegel systematized and Richard Wagner has in the end set to music. Good-natured and spiteful, such a juxtaposition, preposterous in the case of every other people, is unfortunately only too often justified in Germany. One has only to live for a while among Swabians to know this. The clumsiness of the German scholar and his social distastefulness agree alarmingly well with his physical rope-dancing and nimble boldness, of which all the gods have learnt to be afraid. If anyone wishes to see the German soul demonstrated ad oculos, let him only look at German taste, at German arts and manners. What boorish indifference to taste! How the noblest and the commonest stand there in juxtaposition! How disorderly and how rich is the whole constitution of this soul! The German drags at his soul. He drags at everything he experiences. He digests his events badly. He never gets done with them, and German depths is often only a difficult, hesitating digestion. And just as all chronic invalids, all dyspeptics, like what is convenient, so the German loves frankness and honesty. It is so convenient to be frank and honest. This confidingness, this complacence, this showing the cards of German honesty, is perhaps the most dangerous and most successful disguise which the German is up to nowadays. It is his proper Mephistophelian art. With this, he can still achieve much. The German lets himself go, and thereby gazes with faithful, blue, empty German eyes, and other countries immediately confound him with his dressing gown. I mean to say that, let German depths be what it will. Among ourselves alone, we perhaps take the liberty to laugh at it. We shall do well to continue henceforth to honour its appearance and good name, and not barter away too cheaply our old reputation as a people for depths, for Prussian smartness, and Berlin wit and sand. It is wise for a people to pose, and let itself be regarded as profound, clumsy, good-natured, honest, and foolish. It might even be profound to do so. Finally, we should do honour to our name. We are not called the Tusche Volk, deceptive people, for nothing. 245. The good old time is past. It sang itself out in Mozart. How happy are we that his Rococo still speaks to us, that his good company, his tender enthusiasm, his childish delight in the Chinese and its flourishes, his courtesy of heart, his longing for the elegant, the amorous, the tripping, the tearful, and his belief in the South can still appeal to something left in us. Ah, some time or other it will be over with it. But who can doubt that it will be over still sooner with the intelligence and taste for Beethoven? For he was only the last echo of a break and transition in style, and not, like Mozart, the last echo of a great European taste, which had existed for centuries. Beethoven is the intermediate event between an old, mellow soul that is constantly breaking down, and a future, over-young soul that is always coming. There is spread over his music the twilight of eternal loss and eternal extravagant hope, the same light in which Europe was bathed when it dreamed with Rousseau, when it danced round the tree of liberty of the Revolution, and finally almost fell down in adoration before Napoleon.